to have Heather Redman here. You may know Heather. She's very active in the Seattle ecosystem as well. Honestly, I could make a 10-minute introduction, but let me just hit a few highlights. So Heather is currently the VP of Operations and General Counsel at Indix Corporation. Her career spans numerous operational, senior executive, and board roles in companies ranging from entertainment to cloud-based software as a service. Heather is also an active angel investor with investments in startup companies from TechStars, 9 Mile Labs, Founders Co-op, Pioneer Square Labs, and Alliance of Angels, and some out-of-town funds as well. She got her law degree from Stanford, and she's going to talk about being totally goat today. And I know what that means. If you don't know what that means yet, I'm gonna let her tell you. But please welcome Heather to the stage.
This is my Twitter handle. Okay, so GOAT, greatest of all time. This has been a phrase used a lot about the Chicago Cubs, but I think it also applies to Seattle and applies to everybody in this room. This is truly a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. We are here now, and Seattle is so ready to break out, and all of us are on the ground floor. Just by being here in this room, you show that you get it and you're ready to participate. So I'm, you know, super excited to be here and really excited to have you all here with me as part of our GOAT journey. So we're really on the shoulders of giants here. You know, Seattle was born as an entrepreneurial town. This town really was started by people who just wanted to make money, and they were thinking about Alaska, they were thinking about natural resources, and then that graduated into retail, into airplanes, and everything else. So right now, Seattle is headquarters for 5 of the globally most admired top 20 brands. So if you think about Amazon, Starbucks, Costco, Nordstrom, Microsoft, those are the most admired brands in the world, and we're the headquarters for those brands. The people that run those companies live here, and that's no accident. This is an extremely entrepreneurial town with great DNA, and you'll also notice it has great consumer DNA, and that's very interesting because we think of ourselves as a B2B enterprise town. So we really are both, and that's a great perspective to maintain. We're a leader in cloud. I think we are the leader in cloud, and that has been probably the most revolutionary technology over the last 10 years. So that puts us at the forefront of what's happening in technology and really happening in business across the world. We're also the leader in global philanthropy. I heard this morning on NPR that Reuters has said that we're the Silicon Valley for saving people's lives. That's amazing, right? But we are, at the same time that we're doing great things in technology, we're also doing great things in world health, world movements in general, sort of alleviating poverty and addressing sort of the biggest issues of our time. The Bill Gates Initiative on Climate is another one. UW is often ranked at the top or very near the top for recipients of federal dollars. We have a great base here. We could use a few more universities, it's true, but the UW really gets more than its fair share of dollars. And then we have 2 of the top 10 corporate R&D spenders, obviously Amazon and Microsoft. No other state has 2 of the top 10. You know, we're really at the forefront of R&D, both in terms of what our university is doing, but also in terms of what our corporations are doing. We have an innovation score of 90. Silicon Valley has an innovation score of 93. This is something that measures patent filings, measures advanced degrees granted, lots of different factors, but we're only 3 points behind the Valley, and we have these other positives going for us. So if you were to look, you know, if you were from Mars, Elon Musk, thank you. If you were from Mars, you would say, oh, maybe Seattle's number one, because look at these things. You know, there are several factors here that would weigh in favor of Seattle. And then finally, this word that I'm really afraid I can't pronounce, agglomeration. Tech is different than some other industries. Tech really favors sort of the massing of talent. And we started this with Boeing in the space and aerospace area, and we layered it on with Microsoft, and now we're doubling down with Amazon and UW and many of the other companies that are starting here. What that means is that once one company is someplace, if they're a leader in an area, more companies tend to follow. So we're definitely seeing this in cloud. And I think we'll see it in other areas as well. We've got now, I think I inflated this number slightly. The last number I saw was 94,000 or something, but 100,000 software engineers, 10% higher than what they've got in the San Francisco area. 94% of those are out of state, which when I talk to the education people in Seattle, they're horrified. But from a ecosystem standpoint, I think it's great because it shows that we're attracting that talent. There's something here that is making those people say, I want to live here and I want to work here. And that's, you know, really a two-pronged decision, as we all know, because we all have to think about that all the time. But it also brings new blood into Seattle. And as much as I love all of the people who were born and raised here, we need that new blood. That new blood, that in-migration that we have, which is both inside of the United States, but also from around the world, really creates some entrepreneurial strength. Microsoft and Amazon are hiring more MBAs than McKinsey. Wow, that's pretty incredible, because that's all that McKinsey hires, I think, right? So we're really bringing in not only engineering talent, we're also bringing in business talent. And that's significant, because people go to business school for a reason, right? They're not going to business school to just have a job and, you know, kind of do whatever. They have ambition. And MBAs tend to be that way. So this is really good for us that we're having them come into town. Capitol Hill, this is one of the stats that I love. And I've gotten this from a number of sources, and I'm starting to believe it, although I was skeptical at first. 50% of Capitol Hill are now East Coast emigres to Seattle over the last 5 years. So they've looked like, where is my neighborhood? Oh, it's Capitol Hill. So those are people that didn't live here before, and somehow they heard about Seattle and they came here for a job, or they came here to start something, and here they are now. That's good new blood that mixes with our sort of native Seattle ethos and creates some great stuff. We have 85 engineering centers. I think actually this is out of date. I did this slide yesterday. I think it's 86 now. Forget who came in yesterday, but you know, this is Oculus Rift, this is Facebook, this is Google, you name it. Everybody is here, Snapchat, et cetera. And they're coming here because of the talent, and we need to be sure that they keep spawning that talent and they keep coming here because it's good for our ecosystem, but also that we don't ignore the fact that those people who are going to work at Snapchat or Oculus Rift could also start a company that we would like to fund. So this is the downside slide, but it's also the opportunity slide for those of us who are in the room. We're underperforming on capital deployed. We are, gosh, I think a quarter of Boston, and Boston has nothing on us. I mean, Boston's got a lot of healthcare, Boston's got a lot of universities, but in terms of engineering strength and entrepreneurial strength, we should be killing Boston, and they've got, you know, 4x our capital deployed. So this is why this conference is so important and why bringing more people into the ecosystem and investing their dollars is so important. We're also underperforming on startup creation. And I would posit that this is because of the first bullet point. We don't have enough capital sloshing around the system. I like to think of it as the welcome mat of capital. We need to have more capital welcoming companies starting and encouraging them to try. If they fail, that's fine too, but let's get going, let's try. And then we're also underperforming on seed to A conversions. I think we're at about half of the Bay Area level. So what this means is that we may fund them as angels, we may fund them as Series Seed, but we're not getting them to the Series A. And that's crucially important. So us as investors, what we need to concentrate on is not only putting our dollars to work, but also strengthening that connectivity to Series A funders. So market opportunities. We've been talking about some of the fertile soil. Let's talk about some of the green shoots that are coming out of that fertile soil. We are light on research institutions and places where you can get a computer science or MBA degree, but University of Amazon. These guys are rocking it. They are creating new businesses every day. They have a very entrepreneurial structure internally, but it's still a very big company. So people want to be entrepreneurial there. They form new ideas. They bring those ideas up. They get funded. But they're also are learning how to do a startup. Basically, they're doing startups internally. So we want to bring them out and fund them. Everything ass, right? We've got SaaS, we've got DaaS, we've got PaaS, we've got IaaS. You know, there's anything that is a subscription service, anything that can exist in the cloud, we excel at. I'm seeing things like closet as a service now, you know, which actually makes a lot of sense to me. It's a good thing. Machine learning, AI, big area of expertise for us. Microsoft was in way too early, but there's a lot of expertise there that we're now seeing come out and start companies. So that's excellent. And obviously, Amazon is doubling down this area too. Purpose-driven business models. We talked earlier about the philanthropy that we've got here in Seattle. I mean, I think we've got the first and third most, you know, richest people in the U.S. who live here in the city, and we've got Paul Allen too, who doesn't even rank in that sort of echelon. But all of these folks are really wanting to solve world problems, and we have an ethos here in our culture that says that's important. So we're seeing a lot of purpose-driven business models, which doesn't mean nonprofit or impact investing. It just means you are attracting millennials who want to really believe in what they're doing. So it doesn't have to be that separate track. It can still be a full-on for-profit business, but you think of a, you know, even a Tableau or a Rover, they really have a purpose. They're trying to do something that makes people's lives better. VR, AR, a lot of us are more enthusiastic about AR than VR, but these two things are hand in glove, and this is really ours to lose. We have a lot of strength in this area. Healthcare, IT, also, we have a lot of strength here. We've got tremendous investment in healthcare, and then we've got the enterprise heritage that makes us an ideal venue for this, because if you're thinking about your health or your private data, you really want to entrust that to someone who's used to handling very sensitive business information and used to, you know, having virtually 100% uptime. The future of the human-machine interface, this is talked a lot about, you know, Matt McElwain goes on and on about this, which I fully support, but we've got, you know, not only voice as exemplified by some of the work that Microsoft is doing and the whole Alexa team at Amazon, but we also have everything that's going on with AR and VR. You know, we're going to be using our eyes, we're going to be using our brains, we're going to be using voice, we're going to be using touch. We're going to be using every kind of interface, and really figuring out how to break down that barrier and figure out how to do it better is going to be a core competency for Seattle. And then finally, I don't think this gets enough sort of playtime in the software world, but the world of space. With our Boeing heritage and with some of the tax incentives and everything else that have been put in place over the years, we really have a chance to be the world leader in space technology. And I'm hoping that will also include space technology software. And I think that's an area for all of us to watch. Big fan of the Space Angels Network. It's a longer investment cycle for sure, and there's a lot of hardware involved, but it's an area where we in this region can really excel. Okay, now I'm shifting over from the market opportunity to sort of what I hope will be a little bit of inspiration for all of us as individuals, because I think that one of the things that Seattle has struggled with is that we see it, we get it, but we're like, oh, that's that other guy, he's gonna do that, right? And we really all need to step up. And so my message here is really about us individually, whether we're entrepreneurs or angels or investors, you know, through other vehicles, really thinking about how can we take advantage of this life that we have. I'm realizing that this is it, right? We're here. We better make the most of it. And I think we overestimate the risk and underestimate the fact that we're only here for a limited time. So I would urge you to think about one life, but lots of chances. I also like cats. So Sandbox Seattle, this is a little bit my story. So in my world, and I always think it's good to humanize this and bring this back to sort of like, who's that person on the stage? So in my world, I started out as a corporate lawyer. Probably would have gone to business school if I had realized what business school was, but nobody in my family really had gone to college, and I was watching LA Law, and so consequently ended up in law school. Don't make that mistake. But as a result, ended up being a corporate lawyer and really mastered that, right? Still know how to do that stuff. It's good stuff. It's very important in the grand scheme of things. I took it big by going in-house with one of my clients and ended up being the first GC at Getty Images and taking that company public. So look for something that you're really good at, and then you can, you know, take it big, even if it's not your end objective. And then particularly you will sympathize with this as for lawyers is I wanted to branch out to a higher status competency because lawyers are not, you know, that positively viewed in our society. So I really doubled down on the business side. So how do I, you know, lead a product group, do investing, really become a strategic leader as opposed to just somebody who's doing the legal stuff. Make money. This is super important. probably don't have to overemphasize this to this group, but I think that having your eye on the ball and not focusing on sort of, well, this is a cool thing to do, this will lead to making money later. I think making money at every stage of your career is super important, and it's very clarifying. Even when you get to the stage where I am, where you don't actually have to make money, it's still very clarifying to always try to make money, that that is your sort of lodestar. It's a central sort of organizing principle for what you're doing in your business life. Be a platform. So for me, what I look at is how can I have a lot of different things kind of hanging off of who I am and what I do. That means being involved in the community. That means doing things like this. That means helping other people build their businesses on top of what I've built. Servant leader. I think Seattle's actually quite good at this because we're not very egotistical, and maybe we need to be a little more egotistical. But being a servant leader means how do I create success for other people, whether that's the company I invest in, or whether that's I'm a founder, but I have my first employee. How do I make them super successful? How do I make my customers successful? And framing everything from that servant leadership perspective, I think, can be very helpful. Excellence, authenticity, and scale. This is kind of how I think about the pillars of the principles that you should have when you're really thinking about how to organize your investing life or your entrepreneurship. So excellence, find or build the A team. I had a coach that I hired for about 3 months who was ultimately super helpful but also very expensive. So I sort of tried to internalize as much as I could from her during that time. But she said, what you want to be is be part of the A team. And I think a lot of us forget that, and we probably all want to be part of the A team. But we lose focus and we sort of drift into opportunities as they come up. But the A team is the thing that you really want to find. You don't want to chase it, as in, I'm in the A team now. Now I've found the A-plus team and the A++ team. But you want to feel like you're the stupidest person in the room. And then you want to stick with that team. And undoubtedly, you'll start feeling less stupid over time. But that's okay. It's still that A team that you identified on day one. Lean in. I'm a huge fan of Sheryl Sandberg, and I think this principle applies to men and women, and it goes back to that one life concept. There's no sense in doing this unless you're going to go all out, right? So why not? What are you afraid of? There's no reason to hold back. Learn and add value. So for investors, the way I think of this is be curious. You don't have to know everything about the business when you come in. You can confess your ignorance and keep asking questions. And you can also, instead of just saying, hey, I wrote my check, now you guys go make it happen, you can really add value. And the same for the company. Learn from your investor. You don't have to have it all figured out, right? You can ask your investor questions about how to do X, Y, or Z, and you can also add value to your investor. One of the key things about angels is we're not just money, right? We want to feel interesting, and we want to be interested, right? So there's ways that you can add value to our lives as well, just by the connections that you have. So think about how that transaction goes both ways. Don't over or undersell. I think this also applies both to investors and entrepreneurs. So entrepreneurs frequently fall victim to this because we tell you to be strong, to really push your idea and your concept. But you can oversell by misrepresenting facts. What you should do is be very bullish on you, your idea, and your team, but don't exaggerate facts. Facts are facts, right? Don't say that you've got an advisor just because you're talking to somebody, and don't say that you've got a deal just because you've got an NDA signed. That's crucial. Authenticity. Whether you're an investor or an entrepreneur, you are the product. Early stage companies are basically about the team, right? It's the only thing we can actually test. You can talk to us about your TAM, you can talk to us about your business model, you can talk to us about your product, but really the only thing that we can touch and feel is you. So you are the product, and you need to figure out what are you going to exemplify in all of that. And the same as an investor. Your money is coming in, right? But if it's a quality company, they're also really going to care about who are you as an investor. What else can you do for the company? Brand building, things like this. Here I am speaking in front of you. This is an example of brand building. Now you're all going to know who I am. That's super important as you go through your life and your business career. Think about how do you build your brand? Who do you want to be connected to? Be strategic. Authentic. So there's, especially those of us who don't fit sort of the normal mold of, you know, who is an investor. You know, Matt McElwain and I do not look a lot alike. Matt McElwain would never wear these pants. It's all about, you know, being who you are, right? And owning that and being relaxed about that. And I know Matt, you know, I'm sure is very relaxed in, as to who he is as well. Same is true as an entrepreneur. You cannot fit a mold that is not native to you. So be authentic. That builds trust, and trust builds success. Be the chooser. I have an 18-year-old daughter, and I always tell her this when I'm giving her sort of boy advice. I'm like, don't be the choosy. Be the chooser. And you need to be that way as an investor, and you need to be that as an entrepreneur as well. Think about who you want inside your tent and bring those people in. Don't wait for them to come to you. And then finally, be big. I think we all have sort of a line that we draw around our silhouette, and I would encourage all of you to expand that silhouette. So draw that line and then make it 20% bigger or 50% bigger or 100% bigger. Really think about how you can exceed the boundaries that you've set for yourself. And that's particularly important in Seattle, and I would say it's particularly important for people who don't fit the typical mold. Scale, be close to the money. I talked about making money before, but if you're an investor, think about how you can bring more money to the table. Think about how that can manifest itself in terms of customers. Think of how that can manifest itself in terms of additional investors. If you're a entrepreneur, think about how you can make money come to the business. So that's customers, that's investors, but principally it's customers, because we're all, you know, the investors are there, but they'll be there in you know, 2-3x fold if you can bring customers to the table. Think about your journey. This is one step along the journey. So how does this relate to where you're going next? If you're an investor, I always think about how there are many, many synergies. You're investing your money, and that's smart, but you're also advancing your career. You're expanding your network. You're learning all along the way. And the same as an entrepreneur. If you fail at this business, you have learned so much, and you are so valuable to another entrepreneur or to an employer or to another investor. And then Venn diagram. I like to think of my life in Venn diagram terms. So think about how you have a unique spot in some sort of Venn diagram. So maybe I'll give my example. So I am really active in politics. I know the whole Seattle sort of traditional business community, and I know the tech community really well. I don't think there's a lot of people who really occupy all three of those sectors as much as I do. And so that gives me a unique perspective and also some unique value props to certain kinds of businesses. I always include this slide, which I vary from time to time, but these are my sort of life hacks that I think are applicable to anybody. The first one is time over stuff, and my big pet peeve in Seattle is that people are too in love with their houses. And so I urge you, if you have a house that is causing you to commute an hour to your job or an hour to your kid's school or whatever, give that up, rent it to somebody or whatever the heck. But, you know, live close to something is my big motto here. Whether it's your kid's school or your work or whatever it is, or don't live anywhere, you know, just sort of migrate from rental to rental. But don't be attached to a house. It's just a property, right? This is your life. Assistant. I have an assistant who works for me. She's a college student. I've had a series of these folks, and she works for me 5 hours a week. She's the thing that allows me to be a platform. If I didn't have my assistant, I would be busy in my full-time job and doing this, doing that. And if with my assistant, I can be that platform by being connected to a lot of different people at once. Two furs and three furs. Try to think of things in your life that you can sort of tick off two boxes at once. So when I was offered the governance committee chair position at the WTIA, I said, oh, great, because that allows me to call anybody in tech. I can call Spencer Raskoff if I want and say, hey, WTIA needs, you know, a board member from your team. And he'll take that call, right? So think always about how you can kill two birds with one stone. Power couple. This is one of those secret places where women actually have an advantage, demographically speaking. If you are married to somebody who is equally engaged in, or dating somebody who's equally engaged in this whole ecosystem, that's a huge benefit. That person can do a lot for you and vice versa. My husband and I develop a ton of business for each other, and I highly recommend this sort of strategy. So take advantage of that and revel in that if you happen to be the beneficiary, because then you're getting some benefit over the fact that nobody else is cooking dinner. Build up and down. So at the stage I am in life, what's super important for me is to think about people who are in their 20s and to really create relationships with them, both because I get tremendous energy from them, tremendous knowledge from them, but they are going to be huge assets for me when they're in their 30s. And the same with people in their 60s and 70s. Those folks, they're at the top of some sort of pyramid, and they can do tremendous things for me, and they have tremendous wisdom to offer me. So go up and down as well as cross industries. Takeaway, I love the fact you guys are doing the Chinese takeouts. I didn't know that with my slide, but look at that synergy. So be brave, one life. Remember what I said, there really is no risk here in taking the risk that you're taking. It really is going to lead to other things, and you're not gonna be setting yourself back. Be strategic, that's the Venn diagram, that's the power couple, that's the assistant, that's, you know, really thinking things through. Everything you're doing is a bridge, not a dead end. So if you're in a startup and you're wondering whether it's going to succeed, even if it doesn't, it's still a bridge. It really is. So don't be afraid. You are bridging to higher and better things. Servant leader, we talked about that, super important. And then finally, that one life concept. You need to double down on that one life concept. Seattle needs to double down on that one life concept. They get it in the Valley, we need to get it here. This is our time, we are GOAT. You guys can do it, I hope you will. I'm certainly gonna try. So go forth and kick butt.
Thank you, Heather.